It is time for Rockin' Company's Rockin' See You with Adam Munster, Tiger of BuffStampede.com. Of course, brought to you by Rockin' Company, making Colorado beautiful, natural stone construction for five decades. RockinCo.com. And Zadie's Deli, hitting it out of the park. Those great overstuffed sandwiches with corned beef, homemade corned beef, also pastrami and the other deli treats. Free parking front and back, 121 Adams Street, and they cater Zadie's Deli. And good morning, Adam.
Good morning, Michael.
Serious business here as we start off on a gorgeous sunny morning here in Colorado. The investigation just drags on, and maybe in some ways they think it's good out of sight, out of mind. But there's a real cost I'm hearing from folks that Mike McIntyre is not happy about having his extension treated this way, and that he in particular should not be treated this way, since his superiors made most of the decisions on the Tumpkin investigation. Where are we on all this, and what do you feel about that?
Yeah, fortunately, we're getting close to the finish line here, it sounds like. It's been kind of a lengthy process here. It's been now almost 4 months since Joe Tumpkin was forced to resign, and basically 3 months since those lawyers from the Cozen O'Connor firm started billing CU at $1,211 an hour. So they've racked up quite a bill here. The investigation is finally complete, and the CU Board of Regents have called for a special meeting. They're going to meet in Denver on Monday. And it sounds like there's a solid chance in the afternoon they might vote on Mike McIntyre's contract extension proposal. So this is a story with a lot of layers. It's just, certainly we can't go through it all in this segment. And I've done a lot of digging on it, even spent an hour and a half talking on the phone with the victim. So, you know, it's a really, really sad situation. CU admitted that they didn't handle it perfectly, but from what I've been able to gather, this does not come close to being a scandal. And yes, the optics of Tumpkin being able to call the defensive plays in the bowl game looks really bad, but I keep going back to the fact there has to be some sort of due process involved in situations like this. I don't know when it flipped to where you're now apparently guilty until proven innocent, but there's supposed to be some sort of report made public from this investigation, so I guess we'll see if it uncovered anything that wasn't already told in that Sports Illustrated article, which was from the side of the victim. So I would be surprised if there's anything groundbreaking from this investigation, but it did take really long for them to complete it. So we'll see. In terms of McIntyre, yeah, you mentioned you have to wonder, has this whole situation soured him on CU? And the only thing there is time will tell. You know, it's just tough to know at this point. But again, after Monday, we'll have a little bit more clarity.
Well, interesting. Are you willing to handicap what kind of decision will come out of this, and is Mike McIntyre in any jeopardy, or is it just a matter of Mike McIntyre being alienated about being treated this way when his superiors really pretty much called the shots on this thing?
Yeah, I think more the latter. I would be really, really surprised. I think it was the Regents just wanting to be precautious. Even though there's an ethics clause in these contracts, it's still, I think they maybe don't understand the other side of it that we do, that this affects things, and it could potentially sour Mike McIntyre on CU, which you obviously don't want to have happen. It's his contract is a sizable bump up from what he's been getting paid, but it's still, if you look at it, his base salary is basically, if this gets approved, going to put him in the middle of the Pac-12 conference. This is the National Coach of the Year, so it's a modest contract. It certainly should get proposed. And again, I would be really surprised if this investigation uncovers anything earth-shattering in terms of Mike McIntyre's involvement. We know that he went to his superior. Again, this, you didn't handle everything perfectly, but again, I just don't understand how this is viewed by some as a scandal.
Well, we will talk more in depth next week. Really go into it. Including your conversation with the woman who blew the whistle on Tumpkin for the domestic abuse issues that have been raised. Let's go into that next week. This week, we said we were going to talk about who are the three most crucial players in 2017 on the University of Colorado football team, and I'm going to pick a most crucial player out of my three. We'll see what you do.
Okay. All right, I'm going to go third on my list. I've got safety Afolabi Laguda, and I picked him here because the Buffs brought in Javier Edwards to come fill in Josh Tupou's shoes at nose tackle, and I think he's going to do a good job there. So that, to me, makes Tedrick Thompson the most difficult player for CU to replace. You just look at Thompson and his instincts and ball-hawking skills in the secondary. It was such a big part of the Buffs being a top-20 defense last year. And so you have Laguda stepping up there in the secondary as a leader. He's the team's hardest hitter, but you know, frankly, his pass coverage has been spotty and exploited at times. I think back to the USC game last year, tight ends have at times had success against him. So if he can improve in that area in terms of pass coverage, I think Laguda is a legit NFL draft prospect. But if he doesn't, I think he's going to be a weak link at times. So he's a crucial guy for me. Do you want to go with your third, or should I keep going here?
You go right ahead.
Okay. Number two, I've got middle linebacker Rick Gamboa. He's not one of the most talented guys on the team, but I picked him because he's a guy that can quarterback the defense, really the way no one else on this team can. And the Buffs don't have depth at inside linebacker, so you can't afford for a Rick Gamboa to get hurt if you're the Buffs. He stepped up as a leader this offseason like Laguda. He was named the team captain. His athleticism, like I mentioned, kind of limited, but his football IQ is off the charts. And then number one, I'm going to take the safe pick here and go with quarterback Steve Amontez. He's obviously got the physical tools, and he's got the support on offense. You look at that talented receiving group and four or five offensive linemen back, Philip Lindsay obviously to lean on for support on offense. So he should be one of the top quarterbacks in the conference this season. The question there is he going to take the next step in terms of learning the nuances that make for a consistent quarterback at this level? He's gotten in better shape, which is good, but he's still learning how to read defenses quickly. He needs to learn how to not panic at times in the pocket. That was an issue, again, going back to the USC game last year. And basically, for Steve Amontez, just don't rely strictly on your physical gifts. Log long hours in the film room. And he's also got to be a calming influence for the offense, like Sefo Lufau was in the huddle often. And if he can do that, look out.
Can't argue with any of what you just said. I have three different guys. And I looked at it often in terms of who can't you replace, and I didn't put him in 1, 2, 3, although I do have a number one, but I'll say I have a tie at number two with Isaiah Oliver at cornerback, because after losing three drafted defensive backs as a cover corner, he is absolutely the most crucial guy in what was the biggest strength of the team last year. He's got to fill that void. So I've got him with Jeremy Irwin at left tackle, because if the offensive line is solid, and they've lost Irwin for a year before, if the offensive line is solid, I believe Montez will play adequately, if not inspired football, and be okay. But if they lose Irwin, the shuffling that goes on in that offensive line, which right now with four starters back is at five experienced players, is really a strength on this team that I think gives the most optimism for a good season. But the most important guy who's hard to replace is the guy who is not just talented, but has the greatest intangibles on the team, I think, and that is Philip Lindsay, the running back. They've had any number of running backs up there, and none of them do what Philip Lindsay does. None of them have the fire. I don't know how they could replace Lindsay with a powerful guy, with a quick guy, but I don't know anybody who makes more out of plays on either side of the ball than Philip Lindsay, and he, to me, is the most irreplaceable guy on this team.
Yeah, I like your list. One more guy I throw out there is Derek McCartney coming back from that knee injury. And I think people might forget just how good Jimmy Gilbert was as a pass rusher last year. They're going to need Derek McCartney to really step up to coming back from that injury.
Crucial. Why I have optimism about the linebackers, despite the loss of Olabode, for instance, and the retirement of Gillum due to injuries. In our last minute here, let's tell people what's coming up on BuffStampede.com.
Well, we'll try to be tracking what's going on in terms of the Regents meeting on Monday. Obviously, a lot of recruiting stuff. We are finishing up our series of spring reviews, looking at it position by position. And after we're done with that, we're going to jump right into our top 40 Buffs countdown, which everyone seems to enjoy.
BuffStampede.com. Must reading. I read it every week. Adam, thank you.
Thanks, Michael.
All right, big show next week with Adam on the Regents meeting. We'll get into more depth on that beforehand. And that was Rockin' Company's Rockin' CU with Adam Munster Tiger. Rockin' Company, making Colorado beautiful. Natural stone construction, 5 decades. Rockin'Co.com. And Zadie's Deli, hitting it out of park with those great overstuffed sandwiches, the homemade corned beef and the other deli treats. Free parking front and back in Cherry Creek, 121 Adams Street.